Hello. Today we will discuss liver cancer. The main learning objectives are as follow. First, to review causes and clinical presentation of liver cancer, focusing on primary liver cancer. And second, to review the diagnosis and management of liver cancer. The outline of the presentation is as follow. We'll first talk about primary versus secondary liver cancers, followed by etiology and pathophysiology, geography and prognosis, clinical presentation of liver cancer, diagnosis and surveillance, treatment, and finally summary of the presentation. Here's an overview of liver cancers, which is classified by primary liver cancer and secondary liver cancer, or metastatic cancer. There are various types of primary liver cancers, but the most common form is hepatocellular carcinoma, or HCC. One way to classify primary liver cancers is by the cell of origin, which includes hepatocytes, blood vessels, mesenchyme, or germ cells. Just to briefly highlight a few examples highlighted on the slides. Fibrolaminar carcinoma is a subtype of HCC in younger population. Hepatic adenoma is commonly presented by USMLE board exams as a younger female patient who is on oral contraceptives. In pediatric population, we need to think about hepatoblastoma, but as a whole, the other examples listed above are quite rare. We will focus on rest of the presentation on hepatocellular carcinoma. It is important to understand the underlying etiology to form clinical approach to liver cancer because they suggest different pathogenic pathways. HCC most commonly forms from cirrhotic pathway, and causes include hepatitis C, alcohol liver disease, and autoimmune hepatitis. This occurs through a chronic cycle of inflammatory damage and repair of hepatocytes, leading to mistakes during repair that results in carcinogenesis. There are other circumstances for HCC to develop without having a cirrhotic liver, and common causes include hepatitis B, fibrolaminar carcinoma, and non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, or NASH. In hepatitis B, integration of the viral genome into infected cells can directly induce HCC despite absence of cirrhosis. Alpha-toxin is a potent carcinogen produced by certain Aspergillus species of fungus that causes carcinogenesis in the liver. Moving on to the geography prognosis of hepatocellular carcinoma. The geographic distribution is heavily influenced to the frequency of hepatitis B and C. High incidence regions include Eastern Asia and Africa. Eastern Asia has an incidence of 35.5 per 100,000 people, and Africa has an incidence of 24.2 people per 100,000. Intermediate incidence regions include Europe and Southeast Asia, while low incidence regions include the Americas and Australia. The median survival of hepatocellular carcinoma ranges from 6 to 20 months after diagnosis. The 5-year survival for stage 1 HCC is 55%, stage 2 is 37%, and 16% or less for stage 3, and stage 4 hepatocellular carcinoma. Most patients who present with liver cancer are asymptomatic and are diagnosed based on surveillance programs for patients at risk. For others who present symptomatically, they typically present in two groups. The first group presents with physical discomfort, heaviness in the right upper quadrant abdominal region, right upper quadrant pain, or hepatomegaly noticed on examination. The other group presents with first or recurrent decompensated episodes of liver disease. They typically have ascites with or without pedoedema, with or without signs of obstructive jaundice, such as staturia and tea-colored urine. Patient could also present with signs and symptoms of chronic liver disease, such as loss of weight, loss of appetite, jaundice, spider nevi on examination. Other less common signs and symptoms include bone pain from metastasis, hypercalcemia, peritoneal bleed, and paraneoplastic syndrome including hypoglycemia, anemia secondary to low erythropoietin production, and acanthosis nigricans. In clinical practice, hepatocellular carcinoma is the only cancer that can be clinically diagnosed based on radiological features without the need for biopsy. This is done by using a triphasic CT scan, which is a non-invasive imaging used to diagnose liver cancer when the imaging demonstrates focal enhancement in arterial uptake phase followed by washout in a delayed venous phase, and this is pathognomonic for hepatocellular carcinoma. The algorithm used by clinicians is based on the AASLD table shown on the slide. Note that this only represents cirrhotic hepatocellular carcinoma. For liver nodules that are less than 1 cm noticed on ultrasound, the patient needs to repeat ultrasound at 3 months to further evaluate the growth. For liver nodules that are more than 1 cm noticed on ultrasound, the patient needs to undergo either a tri- or four-phasic CT or MRI scan to demonstrate the aforementioned imaging characteristics for HCC to be diagnosed. Liver biopsy should only be done on uncertain lesions. And a final note on the role of AFP, which is a glycoprotein produced by liver and yolk sacs. AFP could be elevated in intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma or metastasis from colon cancer. Therefore, based on the American guidelines, the diagnosis of HCC should only rely on radiological appearances and histology. Surveillance for HCC will start from when liver cirrhosis is diagnosed, with the aim of decreasing mortality from disease via early detection. The above 10 patient groups have been identified in whom surveillance is recommended. And they include Asian men, hepatitis B carriers more than 40 years old, Asian female, hepatitis B carriers over 50 years old, hepatitis B carriers with family history of HCC, blacks with hepatitis B, cirrhotic hepatitis B carriers, hepatitis C cirrhosis, stage 4 PBC, genetic hematochromatosis and cirrhosis, alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency and cirrhosis, as well as other cirrhosis. Surveillance through AFP and ultrasound follow-up every 6 months was found to be the most effective strategy. If nodules are found via routine surveillance programs, the AASLD has specific recommendations on next step management depending on the size of the nodule. For nodules less than 1 centimeter, ultrasound follow-up will be needed every 3 to 6 months. If there's no growth within 2 years, then the patient can be reverted back to routine surveillance. For nodules more than 1 centimeter, a 4-phase CT or MRI scan is necessary. And finally, for smaller lesions, they could be evaluated by biopsy. Management of HCC depends on the staging of the cancer. Before we go over the treatment options, we need to understand the Barcelona Clinic Liver Cancer, or BCLC, staging system. There are 4 stages, A, B, C, and D. Stage A is further broken down to stage A1 to A4. Stage A represents a range of stages from a single tumor less than 5 centimeters for A1 to A3 to 3 tumors less than 3 cm each for A4. It is also based on liver function, with A1 representing no portal hypertension, A2 with portal hypertension but with normal bilirubin levels, and finally A3 representing both portal hypertension with abnormal bilirubin levels. Stage B represents large multinodular tumor without vascular invasion or metastasis, along with a Child Pugh class A or B. Stage C represents large multinodular tumor with vascular invasion or metastasis, also with a Child Pugh class of A or B. Finally, stage D represents large multinodular tumor with any invasion, also represented by Child Pugh class C. Moving on to connecting the staging information to treatment options presented by the previous slides, here's a chart reflecting the BCLC staging information and treatment allocations taken from the AASLD practice guidelines. The best option for treatment depends on the stage. For early stage HCC, patients are candidates for curative treatments. For example, if there's none or early stage lesion less than 2 centimeters, then the best option is resection. If there's early stage with one HCC or three nodules less than or equivalent to 3 centimeters, then the patient is a candidate for curative treatments such as liver transplant or radiofrequency ablation, depending on associated diseases. The intermediate and advanced stage HCC is treated by palliative treatments. If there's intermediate stage B, then the patient is a candidate for TACE. Similarly, if there's advanced stage, stage C HCC, then the patient is a candidate for sorafenib. For any more advanced HCC, the patient is treated for symptomatic treatment. Here's a summary of the key learning points from this presentation. Hepatocellular carcinoma is the most prevalent primary liver cancer. Hepatocellular carcinoma is driven by either a cirrhotic or non-cirrhotic pathway. The diagnosis, surveillance, and treatment of hepatocellular carcinoma is based on the AASLD practice guidelines. And special thanks to Dr. Jason Chang for all his help in the preparation of this PowerPoint presentation. Thank you very much for listening.